What's up, guys? Gamer 1, 2, and 2, and it's discussion day, I guess. Dream card day? Ah, yes, and today we're going to be doing a part 2 of my last discussion video, talking about the Sacred Beast structure deck, or the possibility of one. Last time, I took all of your scrub dreams and I just shat all over them to tell you that you are bad and should feel bad for even voting for that deck, because it's going to ruin the game. Hyperbole aside, I do stand by my statements that if we want Konami to continue to ask the player base for its input when creating cards and things like that, we should probably give them constructive that will sell well, so therefore they are more financially inclined to keep the player base in the loop. However, on that video, there was a couple people that mentioned that they only voted for the Sacred Beast deck simply because they want to watch Konami struggle to make those cards work. Because as you know, the three Sacred Beasts, Hamon, Raviel, and Hamon and Urea,
Metal Silver Overdrive!
Don't really have much to do with each other, other than the fact that you can fuse them all together to make that stupid Armor Tile of the Chaos Phantom thing. If that fusion didn't exist, I don't think anyone would ever consider putting all three of these in a deck because they seem to be boss monsters of different strategies. Urea wants to sack three continuous trap cards to put itself on the field and gets attack power based on what's in the grave. Hamon wants to do it for spells, and Raviel wants to do it with face-up fiend monsters. If it wasn't for that fusion, I don't think anyone would even think to put these in one deck. However, it exists, so the scrubs want to shove it into one deck. And you know what? I'm going to do Konami a favor here, and I'm going to come up with my best attempt at making these things playable as one cohesive strategy. So I'm going to give you 5 card suggestions that are designed by me, with some vague input from some of the comments on that other video, in an attempt to make this deck playable. I'm gonna preface this with, I'm pretty proud of my problem-solving card text, but it might not be perfect. Also, I didn't wanna make these things broken because I was trying to go for the kind of card that might actually get printed, not the stupid fantasy card that the fanboys want, because that never happens when it comes to legacy support. We don't get broken garbage. We just get like mediocre meh that makes the deck at least kind of work. So in that idea moving forward, these are my thoughts. But before we get to the created cards, there is some existing support that I actually want to bring to light. The normal spell martyr thing is kind of bad, ignore it. And Dark Summoning Beast, he's okay. He cheeses out one of the Sacred Beasts. However, he's like a tribute summon level 6 or whatever, kind of meh. And I didn't want to base the deck around him. You can run him if you want and the deck will work with him in it, but it is not the core strategy because I actually wanted these things to be summoned by kind of like their own actual summoning condition. Mostly because it's more fun that way if you can make it work. But the card that I do want to bring to light before we talk about the other cards is Fallen Paradise. Fallen Paradise is a field spell with the following effect. Your opponent cannot target Hamon, Urea, Raviel, or Armatile with card effects. Woot. Well, on the field. I guess they could call it by the grave one. And if you control one of those guys, you can draw 2 cards. This is fantastic. What a really, really good, powerful field spell. It's a damn shame that it's stuck in such a bad, non-cohesive strategy. Haha! Or at least it is, until I get a hold of it. Yeah, this is the previous support I Defsees wants to keeps because that's a good field spell. Well, also, we just had Terraforming a Metaverse hit, and that's bad, ooh. So, crud, we'll have to fix that too. Ugh, can't have anything nice. But anyway, let's get started with the Dave Fantasy Card Channel. Before we get started though, I should preface this, I don't own any of this artwork, so don't sue me. Hell, if you want me to credit you and you happen to be watching this, even though the likelihood of that is almost zero, I'll stick it in the description, I guess. I don't even remember where I got half of this crap. First, create a card we got going for us is Paradise Lost. See what I did there? I thought it was clever. Paradise Lost is a normal spell card that reads, add one Urea, Lord of Searing Flames, Hamon, Lord of Striking Thunder, or Raviel, Lord of Phantasms, from your deck to your hand. You can only activate one of these things once per turn. Yeah, it's just a Rota. We don't really have a good way of searching these things. Figured if you're gonna try to summon them, probably should, you know, have a way of getting to them. And I wasn't gonna try to make it some cheesy, like, banish a continuous trap from the graveyard UA kind of search card that's bullcrap. No, it's just a Rota. I wanted this to be good, but not broken. I think this accomplishes that. The next card is a main deck effect monster called Acolyte of Phantasms. I think this is like a Hearthstone art, I don't know. Acolyte of Phantasms is a level 3 Dark Fiend with 1000 attack, 0 defense, with the following effect. Once per turn, quick effect. You can discard this card, except during the main phase. Add one Fallen Paradise from your deck to your hand, and then end the current phase. The idea being that it can end your opponent's turn during, like, maybe a standby where they're trying to set up some sort of weird, stupid lock on you, or maybe they're going in during their battle phase to hit you with all the damage. And I wanted to basically give the deck an in-theme way of searching their Fantastic Field spell, as well as basically acting as a battle fader. And I thought it'd be balanced by tying them into the same effect, so if, you know, you can't stop your opponent from OTKing you if you just happen to draw all of your paradise cards or something like that, because then it's like, well, I have no viable targets, I can't use its stupid effect. So that's me trying to balance the damn thing. You can banish this card from your graveyard, except the turn it was sent there, to add one Storm of Striking Thunder or Inferno of Searing Flames from your deck to your hand. Those two cards are the next ones, so, you know, spoiler alert. You can only use each of these effects once per turn, and you cannot special summon from your extra deck, except Chaos Phantom monsters. I'm trying to make sure you can't use these things in other decks. That was probably the most important thing about this whole thing. He's a tour guide target, so, you know, you can totally summon him out of the deck with your tour guide, going to Dante, get some stuff in the grave. You know, it seems good for deck thinning. I'm sure you could play like a Burning Abyss Engine, which also kind of helps you for Ravuel. It's a fiend, so, you know, it's also there. And like I said before, it searches the field spell and acts as like a battle fader. So, woot. The except during the main phase thing, though, I stuck at the beginning was so that you can't just end your opponent's main phase, because that would seem way too strong and really dumb. However, I did want to keep you from getting OTK'd, because a lot needs to go right to get all three of these stupid things on board. All right, here we go. One of the two targets that this card can grab is Storm of Striking Thunder. Storm of Striking Thunder is a continuous spell that has the following effect. Cannot be tributed. Sorry, True Draco. You can't use this. That was the whole point. After this card is activated, you can play two more copies of itself from the deck or graveyard to the field. See what I'm doing there? It's a continuous spell that plays two more copies of itself to get you to three for Hammond. They don't do anything other than that, so I think it's fair. It doesn't like have some sort of weird continuous ability if you only played the one or something like that. Plus, if you milled some off of Dante, it gets them out of the grave. So if you happen to lose one for some reason, it doesn't completely bork the strategy. Kind of like the Destiny Boar or something like that. If this card is sent from the field to the graveyard, you can special summon it as a normal monster, level 1, 0-0 attack, Dark Fiend. Basically, if you play one of these things and you get the other two, you sack them for Hammond, they go to the grave, all three chain, summon themselves back as fiends, so now you can make Ravuel. Woot. But also normal monsters, meaning that was my way of making it so you can now tribute them for Ravuel because they don't have an effect anymore. I think that's how it would be ruled. If not, that was the intent. I didn't want to put in, no, you can't play this in True Draco as part of the card text. That'd be goofy. This was my attempt of trying to get around that and still make it work for... You know what I'm trying to say. You can only use each of these effects once per turn, even though the first one, I'm not even sure how you would use more than one anyway. And you are locked into extra deck summoning of only Chaos Phantom monsters like the monster card did. The other target for Acolyte would have to be Inferno of Searing Flames. It's literally a continuous trap card version of the spell. It does exactly the same thing. Can't be tributed. When you play one, it plays the other two. You can sack them, they come back as fiends. And it locks you into Chaos Phantom monsters. As a continuous trap card, it's a little slow. That was kind of the idea for the Battle Fader guy. However, Temple of the Kings totally works in this deck, so that's kind of cool. It's also a continuous spell card, so there's some synergy there. Neat. I don't know else what to say. It's exactly the same card. And the Piece de Resistance. The entire reason why you'd want to put all the work into getting these things on the board, because that was kind of the whole thing that no one in the comment section of the last video really considered, and is that, yeah, you can make cards to cheese these things out, but they themselves, the Sacred Beasts don't do very much, and Armatile the Chaos Phantom is just a giant 10k beater, so it's like, with battle protection that it doesn't really need. It's got 10k attack, I guess it's only on your turn, but whatever. It's at least in some way a little redundant, right? So sure, I made all these cards that makes it easy to get to the field spell, as well as actually get the bad boys on board and search them. But like, we need a reason to want to do that. Now that we've done all this work and played this janky ass deck just to get three beaters. Well, that's why you make this bad boy. Armatile, the Guardian Chaos Phantom. Level 12, Fusion Fiend Effect with 00. Looks familiar. It's made of the three Sacred Beasts. You can special summon this card from your extra deck by sending the above three monsters from the field to the old Banish Pile. As a contact fusion, you don't need polymerization. So it's got the same summoning condition as regular Armatile. However, once per turn, as a quick effect, you can return one face-up Armatile the Chaos Phantom from your field or graveyard to your extra deck to special summon this thing out onto the field as like a kind of like Dragon Buster, basically a quick play tag out. It himself counts as Armatile the Chaos Phantom while on the field, and during your opponent's turn, it has 10k defense. Ah! So it's kind of got that UA feel to it, where you have Armatile original as a 10k attacker and you have this guy as a 10k defender. You hot swap them between turns so that your opponent has to deal with this thing in defense mode instead. It also can't be killed by battle, just in case. And as a defensive floodgate monster, it needs to have some sort of self-protection other than the battle protection, which is ridiculous. So I added a clause: while you control your Fallen Paradise, your opponent cannot special summon from their extra deck. I thought it'd be ridiculous to give this thing like a bunch of negates or keep a non-tributing clause on it or something so you can't kaiju it and make it overpowered and dumb. No, I tried to make it fair. You can dodge targeting effects by hot swapping with the other Armatile. You can go for an OTK with the other Armatile. The field spell protects you from targeting abilities as well. And you can leave this thing on your side of the field during your opponent's turn with its 10k defense to lock them out of your extra deck, a la the Domain of the Monarchs. Which means, now that you put all of that work into making this big dumb thing, it's actually doing something to actively stop your opponent and actually be worth all the effort. However, it's not also not stupidly broken, because we did make it much easier to make the other three Gats. So that was my take on what your Sacred Beast structure deck or deck building set legacy support cards would actually have to be in order to make this thing function as a coherent strategy. If you guys have any ideas how to, you know, expand upon this, or if you think that, you know, I did something I shouldn't have, or, you know, whatever, that's the discussion part of the video, and I'm very curious to see what you guys think. So anyway, guys, let me know down in the comments below what you guys think of these cards. And remember, guys, if you don't troll the meta, who will? I will see you guys next time.
Heh, clicking the subscribe button's a good move. I guess there's a first time for everything. Feel free to click on these third-rate videos from a fourth-rate YugiTuber. But I don't have time for such amateurs. Come on, Mokuba, let's go get ice cream.